Now you know the reasons for managing your money, let's start to find out the hows of money managing. These are my 7 laws of managing your money wisely. The effect of these laws is cumulative, which means that the more of these laws you apply into your life, the bigger the impact will be. The first law is the law of planned budgeting. It is important that you identify your income and expenses. You probably know roughly how much you earn each month, but do you also know where it all goes? Find out by tracking what you're spending. Spend as you normally would, but for a few days or weeks, write down every cent that you spend. It's easy, and you might be amazed by what you find out. When I started to create a budget for myself, I found out that I bought a lot of expensive food, books, and entertainment that I didn't really need. Awareness is key. Once you know what you spend your money on, you can set a realistic budget. Take a sheet of paper. At the top of the paper, start with writing down your income. If you are not sure what it is, or it fluctuates every period, take an average or estimate it. You can either do a monthly, fortnightly, or weekly budget, depending on what works best for you. When I lived in Australia, I got paid on a weekly basis, so I had a weekly budget. Now I live in Thailand, I receive a monthly income, so I have a monthly budget. Choose what period of time works best for you. Below your income, start to write down your expenses that are most consistent. For most people, it starts with rent or a mortgage payment and related household expenditure, such as bills for electricity, gas, water, and internet. After that comes transport, food, clothing, and any other expenses you might have, such as entertainment, fitness, holidays, etc. Finally, leave about 5% extra for incidentals in your budget to give you a little bit of a buffer. This 5% is calculated on top of all your expenses together. So, if your total expenditure is $1,000 every month, leave an extra 5%, which is $50, for incidentals. Since budgeting allows you to create a spending plan for your money, it ensures that you will always have enough money for the things you need and the things that are important to you. Following a budget will also help you to stay out of debt or help you to work your way out of debt. To get out of debt, simply take your total debt and divide it by the number of periods that you want to pay it off in. This gives you the amount of money you have to pay off in every period. Set up an automated debt repayment plan so it's non-negotiable and you can focus on work and business to generate the income to pay it off. What you focus on expands. If you focus on debt, your debt expands. When you focus on working and building your business will expand. Let's say that you have $10,000 in interest-free debt and you want to pay it off within a year. If you want to pay it off monthly, you simply divide $10,000 by 12 months, which gives you about $835 a month to pay off. However, if you want to pay it off weekly, you simply divide $10,000 by 52 weeks, which leaves you with a payment of $192 a week. Sounds better than a lump sum of $10,000, isn't it? Then you can ask yourself how much service you have to provide in that period to pay off the debt. If you have multiple debts, pay off the crucial debts first, such as loans or mortgage repayments, since there are often severe consequences if you don't pay them off. The bank could repossess your house and you have no place to live in. After that, pay off the debts with the highest interest payments, such as credit cards, that often charge 15 to 25% in interest rates. Finally, pay off the debts that are left over. If you are living by yourself, a budget is much easier to do than when you have a family. I live by myself and I know exactly what I need and I'm able to delay certain expenditure. However, if you have a family with kids, I do understand that it's a bit harder than that, especially if you have kids that are young and they are growing. They simply need new clothing every few months since they grow so fast. They also need piano lessons, school fees, etc. Make sure you calculate that into your family's budget. I would also involve my kids and partner when making the initial budget, so they can learn how to manage their money from a young age and value money more. And there's also great communication in your family. You can even let your kids work for some pocket money, so they learn how to be of better service and how to make their budget and save a portion of their income. My parents never gave me any pocket money. Instead, I was able to work evenings after school and on the weekends in my dad's company. I also delivered newspapers a couple of days a week and I sold vegetables from our garden in the summer. At that time, I was mad since many of my friends and classmates got pocket money and I didn't. Instead, I had to work for it. But now I'm so grateful for that experience, since it helped me to budget my expenses and income. It also helped me to value money and it set a foundation for me to be able to leave the house and live all by myself at the age of 17 years old on the other side of the world, while also paying my own university fees. Furthermore, it helped me to plan my time better, be more disciplined, and to think long term. So, if you have kids, in my opinion, there's no better gift you can give them than the gift of independence by the age of 18 or even younger. Your kids will feel proud of themselves afterwards and you can have peace of mind that they will have a great future. Kids who are given everything by their parents are often known as spoiled brats. They don't value money and they take things for granted. This is why they are often less creative and resourceful than people who had some challenges and had to look after themselves without just getting everything for nothing. Lastly, you have to separate wants and needs on your budget. Ask yourself, do I want this or do I need this? Will spending this money get me closer to my financial goals or further away? Can I live without these expenses? Set clear priorities for yourself and your financial decisions become easier to make. Pause the track now and really do this budgeting exercise. The second law is the law of consistent review and evaluation. Once you have a budget, you have to track your expenditure and compare them to your budget. You can do this by simply writing down on paper what you spend and what you make. Or you can use computer programs such as Excel to track expenses and income. I personally use Quicken. I can simply use my phone to type in my expenses on the go in the Quicken app, after which it sends this data to my laptop and adds up my income and expenses automatically. However, there's one tricky thing that you have to be careful of. When you monitor and track your expenses, you could sometimes feel discouraged or depressed when you see the balance, the difference between income and expenditure. If it's in the red instead of the black, you don't have enough money to pay your bills. Now, don't let the monitoring push you down and realize it's the right thing to do to get your financial house in order. I can't stress you how important this is. Kind of separate your finances from yourself and see it as a separate being. Your finances do not necessarily define you. It is just a screenshot of how well you are doing financially in your life at that moment. On a weekly or monthly basis, review your budget with your real spending and look for any discrepancies. Perhaps you didn't budget enough for some items, or you forgot to take into account some unexpected expenses. This way you will be able to improve your budget for the next period and you know what has to be done to make it balance. On the topic of money, there are always a lot of new things happening, but budgeting hasn't changed for centuries. It is exactly the same as it's always been. It also doesn't matter what your income or expenditure is. It's about the difference between them and to make sure it is balancing or shows a positive, Why? Because if you spend more than you earn, you have to start to borrow money from your bank or your family, and you most likely have to pay interest on it. So don't get into that trouble and balance your finances. If you are in the positive, you have some money to invest or extra money to put into your savings account. The next law, number 3, is the law of disciplined saving. It is important that you set aside a portion of your income every week or month, either a percentage or a specific amount, whichever is greater. Rich people pay themselves first, and poor people pay themselves last. When you save, you show the world that you value yourself. When you value you, the world will value you in ways that you could never visualize before. I recommend you to start saving 10% of your income per month. With internet banking, you can set up an automatic monthly transfer from your checking account into your savings account, so you don't have to think about it and it's non-negotiable. When you have a way out or you have to do it manually, there is a higher probability that you won't do it, so you will delay it or even forget about it. I learned this lesson by applying for a gym membership. The only method of payment they accept is automatically every month from my credit card. Every month, my membership fee is being automatically withdrawn. It is non-negotiable, and for me it is much harder to cancel my membership than if I have to pay the fee in the gym and I have a chance every period to cancel or I simply don't pay. Moreover, it is not about the amount of savings, it is about the habit. Even if your income is very low or you don't have any income at all, you can still start and do it. There was a period in my life when I was relocating and I didn't have a regular income. I had to borrow money in order to survive. So what I did was, every time I got some change from a shop, I would save that money and put it into my savings account. It was just a little bit of money every month, but it created the foundation for my wealth building. Then I started to make an income, both online passive income and offline active income. I started to generate an income to pay back what I borrowed, and I started to increase my savings. I recommend you to increase your savings amount by 10% every 3 months. Why a 10% increase? First of all, 10% is very easy to calculate. Secondly, your brain can handle a 10% fluctuation. Less than 10% has just a small impact, while more than 10% could make you feel stressful and worried instead of peaceful and present. This will also help you to keep expanding your mind and your thinking in anticipation of the increase in savings in 3 months' time. Pause the recording now and go to set this up. You can simply do it by logging in your internet banking to set up future withdrawals into your savings account, or you can talk with your financial advisor or bank to have it set up. The next law is the law of profitability. This is a very important law, and when you understand this, it has the power to improve your life. Profitability can come in many forms. With everything you do, it is important to make a profit and to give a profit to others also. I will give you 3 forms that profit can come in, and all of them will affect your money management. Of course, the first form of profit is money. Without profit in terms of money, there would be no economy, businesses, or jobs. The world economy is based around making a profit. On a macro level, businesses buy materials, create products, and sell products for a profit. That profit enables them to hire staff, do research, pay taxes, and ultimately pay back the profits to society. You can do the same on a micro level. Every time you buy something, ask yourself, will this make me a profit? Will it help me to make more money in some way, shape, or form? For example, you might look at purchasing new shoes. When you ask yourself if it will make you a profit and help you to make more money, you will start to evaluate the use of the shoes and make sure it helps you with your job, helps you to look good, and possibly make new connections, while also providing you with a great deal as to how much you pay for them. Or maybe you are looking for a place to eat. When you ask yourself if the restaurant or food will make you a profit, you make a better quality of choice and go for healthy food that doesn't cost too much while it also helps you to get more energy and feel better. You can even ask yourself if you want to spoil yourself. I often go for a luxury massage because it helps me to relax, I get great ideas, and it helps me to serve my clients better afterwards. So, making a profit isn't necessarily about being frugal and hoarding money. It is a new and innovative way of living your life the way you want it, and that will benefit you and those people you love and care for. The second form of profit is a little bit different and is not directly related to money. But please stay with me, because it will really help you in the long term to manage your money better, and it could explain a lot of issues you may have in your life right now. So the second form of profit is energy. I know it sounds a little bit hoo-hoo, but it's very important to make and give a profit in terms of energy. Think about it, the highest paid people in the world often have high levels of energy. Entertainers, singers, and movie stars who show great positive energy are often highly paid and they attract millions of fans. So, how can you start? A simple question to ask yourself is, will this person or activity drain my energy or give me more energy? Have you ever had a conversation with someone and felt drained afterwards? They were drama and complaining about their life or talking how bad the world is. You don't need to be drained of your life energy. Your responsibility here is that you shouldn't allow it into your life. This draining energy makes you tired and makes you have little energy to use for that which is really important to you. Moreover, draining energy might cause health issues if you have to endure it over long periods of time. It could cause stress and anxiety and deplete your life energy. These are simple symptoms of your body telling you to stay away from drama and draining people and activities. There's also the other side of the equation. Are you draining other people of their energy, or do you give energy back to them in some way, shape or form? Are you the one who is complaining about your life, being drama and fighting with the people around you? Stop immediately and start to relax and calm down. Do some meditation. Take a deep breath and count to 10, as simple as it may sound. Sometimes to be quiet is better than to reply to draining energy or to send draining energy. This might mean that you have to stop contact with certain people in your life. Temporarily, it might feel as a loss, but I promise you that great new people will come into your life to take their place. The third form of profit is also not directly related, but it's very important and will help you to increase the quality of your life. It is a profit in terms of joy. When you enjoy that what you do, you enjoy the company you keep, and you love your life in general, you tap into the abundance that is available to you right now. When you enjoy yourself, you give people around you permission to enjoy themselves as well. You make a profit for yourself and give them a profit in the terms of joy and happiness. The opposite is true too. When you are down, you look sad and grumpy, you have the possibility to transfer these emotions to others. Become really conscious of how you look, what emotions you feel, and how you impact other people. Smile more often, exercise and work out to feel more enjoyment in your life that you can use for yourself and to impact other people positively. So, start to become more conscious about the things that drain you of your money, energy, and joy, and move towards making a profit in terms of these three profit areas. The fifth law is the law of clarity. The clearer you know your goals and the results that you're after, the easier it becomes for your brain to help spot opportunities and act upon these opportunities. Some teachers present this law as the law of creative visualization, and others teach it as the law of attraction. It all comes down to knowing your outcome, what it is that you want to create. It is very important to make this as clear as possible in your head. How much do you want to earn? And by when? What would you like your net worth to be? And by when? What kind of lifestyle do you fancy? And how much will it cost? I learned this law from a young age. When I was 17 years old, I moved to the other side of the world, to Australia, to study there. I don't come from a wealthy family, and my dad said I can go to move there if I was able to support myself. He loaned me the money to pay for my first semester at university, and after that I was on my own. I was crystal clear that I wanted to make $300 profit a week, which will pay for my study while also living for free and not having to pay rent. I got this idea from a few friends of mine who were living in the city in a huge apartment, and they were sharing the rent amongst their friends. Every day I was walking past this gorgeous building, and I was crystal clear that I wanted to live there one day, while my expenses were looked after. A few weeks later, I walked past the building again, and I received a newsletter from a real estate agent that advertised an apartment in that building. It was within my price range, and I thought it was amazing. I called the agent while I was walking around the building. The realtor was shocked that I called so quickly, since he just posted the newsletter online a few minutes ago. He was still in that apartment, so I was able to go for an inspection within 5 minutes, and an hour later I signed the lease. Inside the apartment, I got a crystal clear picture in my mind how to organize it in such a way that I could create a win-win-win situation. I would provide quality accommodation for other students, live for free myself, and also having some money to pay for my studies. The next day I went to IKEA, and I got 8 big shopping trolleys full of furniture. I placed an advertisement on the university website, and within a week my apartment was full with happy students, allowing me to study and live for free. To this day I am still friends with many of them. The clearer you know what it is that you want, the easier it becomes to spot opportunities and act upon them to achieve your goals. It is also important to stick to your goals and not constantly change them. If you keep changing your goals very often, you become confused and you don't know which opportunities are right for you. Uncertainty is the enemy of achieving your goals and outcomes. On the other hand, certainty that you will absolutely reach your goals will help you to act upon the opportunities that match them. Set clear financial objectives and state them in the present tense with a deadline. For example, I earn $5,000 a month by the 31st of December. If you are not sure what goals to set, ask yourself this question. What do I wish my finances to look like 6 months from now? Or what do I want my finances to look like 1 year from now? This will also help you to make smart spending choices and become more creative in your work and service to increase your income. More tips and tricks on how to increase your income will be given later in this program. The sixth law of money management is the law of protection. It is very important that you protect your health and your finances. These two areas are most important for managing your money wisely. You can simply protect your health by taking up health insurance while also doing an annual health checkup for yourself and for your family. I personally have excellent health insurance that pays for all my medical expenses, no matter where I live in the world. I simply make a picture of any doctor's bills, I email it to my insurance company, and the refund is in my bank account within a few days. Moreover, it is important to do an annual health check. Check your weight, your body mass index, blood pressure, heart rate, and do a blood test, and so on. Most diseases don't give you any symptoms, and spotting them on time allows you to get a proper treatment and to stay healthy, so you can continue to serve more people and have enough energy and vitality to do so. Make sure that you exercise at least 30 minutes a day to stay in good shape. Drink plenty of water, think balanced and positive thoughts, and be curious and grateful for your life. To protect your finances, it is important to have the right asset distribution. I'm sure you heard the proverb, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Don't put all your money into one asset, such as your house, or all your money in a savings account with just one bank. I myself have my wealth spread over 4 continents with different banks. This also allows me to use money on that continent when I travel, which saves me a lot of conversion and money exchange fees. It is important to start with savings. Have a big enough cushion that lasts for at least a year. This serves you to calm down your emotions. It acts as a money magnet to help you to create more money. After you have built this cushion, only then you can start to put it into an investment account with little risk. When that cushion is enough to last for a year, you can take even more risk while you educate yourself and read books on the next level of risk and reward. Unfortunately, many people act greedy and they want to get rich quick. They just want to put all their money in an investment account and buy some random shares that are being promoted by their broker. To invest is playing in a zero-sum game. When you win, someone else loses money, and when you lose, someone else makes money. And you are betting against everyone else in the world. You even bet against supercomputers and experienced financial experts who can often control the share price with a single tweet or newsletter. Save first and start to educate yourself on what investments are right for you. This will help you to protect your financial future and to help you to manage your money wisely. The 7th and final law is the law of true wealth. Wealth is not just about money. Wealth actually means whole being or well-being. It is an integrated way of living, living in good health, growing in all areas of your life, and feeling well in general. The number one key here is gratitude. The more things you are grateful for, the more things you will receive to be grateful for. I highly recommend you to keep a gratitude journal and to document during the day at least 5 to 10 things that you are grateful for that day. Especially on so-called bad days, I urge you to come up with at least 10 things. I have kept a gratitude journal for many years now, and every day I receive more things to be grateful for. Whether it's a new lesson, a new distinction that I can use to help someone, or just a great conversation with a friend or client, there's always something to be grateful for. However, one day I couldn't write anything to be grateful for. It seemed that the whole world was against me and everything went wrong. This was actually imbalanced thinking from my side. I learned some great lessons that day and ended up documenting more than 10 things that I learned and I'm grateful for. The more you can see the hidden order in things, the yin and yang so to speak, the more fulfilled your life will be and the more balanced, present and poised you are. When it comes to wealth and money management, ask yourself, where am I wealthy already in my life? Wealth comes in many forms. Perhaps it's in your social circle, or maybe you have a lovely family and a great relationship, or you're always in perfect health. The more you can feel and harness that sense of wealth, the easier it becomes to do better financially. Wealth is a mindset and you can tune into it at any moment. So, don't wait and start to feel the wealth in your life. How much wealth is in your life that you didn't have to do anything for? The roads you drive on, the place you live in, the clothes you wear. You didn't have to make them and it was all made and done for you to enjoy. This will also help you to create an abundance mindset. You may ask yourself, what is an abundance mindset? An abundance mindset is a strong feeling that you will always have enough. It is the opposite of a scarcity mindset, whereby you think that you won't have enough. Symptoms of a scarcity mindset are negative feelings, like thinking that you miss out because someone else has something. or feeling bad when you bought something expensive and start to worry how you will pay the bills. When you have that abundance mindset, you know that there is plenty to go around and that things will always work out for you. You bless the wealth of other people and you feel content with what you have right now. Even when I didn't have a lot of money, I still had an abundance mindset because I knew in my heart that I was on the right track. I was also very content with what I had in my life. Now I'm wealthy in financial terms, I still feel and have that abundance mindset. I would like to finish this section with a quote from the late Wayne Dyer, which is something to think about. He said that abundance is not something we acquire, it is something that we tune into.